urbanism. Through this prize, we have recognized distinguished architects and urbanists around the world who have dedicated themselves to the ideas and ideals of the traditional city and its architecture. Richard, on behalf of the faculty, the students, and staff at the School of Architecture, we extend our deep gratitude. That means we're leaving the Harvard. I'd also like to thank the chair of our advisory council, Matthew Walsh, who introduced the school to Richard Driehaus many years ago. We're also grateful for all the incredible contributions that he and Joyce Walsh have made to our school's legacy and our future home. Matt. So now it's my great pleasure to introduce our 2017 laureate of the Richard H. Driehaus Prize, Robert Adam. I have known Robert for over 3 decades. And in that time, I've been impressed not only by his intellect, but also by the breadth of his impact. In addition to his practice, he has fostered dialogue between positions that have become very polarized, especially in recent years. Notions of the traditional and the modern, the global and the regional, or the local, the private and the public. He has done this through his advocacy within the Royal Institute of British Architects, his writings, and his work as a practitioner. From a successful practice that under his leadership has transformed communities with magnificent buildings and thoughtful master plans, to his well-formed scholarly writings and his activism, he has spread the message of traditional architecture and urbanism around the globe. Robert Adam received his architectural education at Westminster University and was a Rome Scholar in 1972-73. In 1977, he became the Director of Architecture and Urban Design Practice, now known as Adam Architecture. Robert, with clients in a wide range of projects, including master planning, public and commercial buildings, extensions to historic buildings, and private houses. In 2010, Adam Urbanism was founded to recognize the growing portfolio of contextual urban design work. First, with the Prince of Wales estate, the Duchy of Cornwall, and subsequently with a wide range of public and private landowners. Robert was active in the founding of the International Network for Traditional Building Architecture and Urbanism, fondly known as INTBAU, established in 2001 to connect organizations and practitioners interested in traditional architecture and urbanism and bring their ideas to a wider audience. He's the author of numerous essays as well as books. Most students will recognize Classical Architecture, Complete Handbook, The Globalization of Modern Architecture, I have a handy copy right here, and Classic Columns, 40 Years of Writing on Architecture, recently published just this year. Robert is a fellow of the Royal Institute of Arts, an academician at the Academy of Urbanism, a senior fellow of the Prince's Foundation for the Built Environment, and founder and past chair of the College of Chapters at INTBAU. He has been a Royal Institute of British Architects Award judge for 9 years, was twice elected by membership to the governing RIBA Council, Royal Institute of British Architects, and from 2001 to 2003, became honorary secretary, at which time he founded the Traditional Architecture Group. For his seminal role in facilitating dialogue about architecture and providing a link between the various strands of thought, for his dissemination of ideas on topics ranging from classicism and urbanism, the global, the local, practice and theory, the jury of the Richard H. Driehaus Prize selected Robert Adam as the 15th laureate of the Richard H. Driehaus Prize at the University of Notre Dame. So, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Robert Adam.
I'm switched on, I think. Well, thank you very much, Michael. I was embarrassing standing through those moments, but I didn't realize I'd lived that long. I also have to thank Richard, who made this lecture possible, and of course for all the people who voted for me to be a laureate. Tremendous honour. One of the greatest honours, actually, is the association it brings me with Richard, and Richard, all that Richard has done for our traditional cause. So I'm sure we will clap Richard again if we like, but probably had enough clapping for time, Richard, being a bit irritated. But Richard, thank you very much. And by the way, thank you to everyone here at Notre Dame. Being here is like being back home, it really is. I do come from time to time. And many a time I've stared across this room to make sure that nobody leaves halfway through. Don't you dare. Now, there's the title. I'm not going to do the usual put up and point of my buildings. I see there's plenty of pictures of them out there, so you can see them. It's not a problem. And I've seen them so much I get bored with it. So I thought a more interesting subject is actually talk about architecture in the world in general, because that's all we do. About 8 or 9 years ago, I wrote this book. It's published a bit less time than that. It takes a while to publish. And the reason for writing it, and I'll just try to be brief about it. I originally started off thinking, well, I'd like to get a really clear view of where architecture is at the moment. You know, everyone wants to do that, of course. But I realized after a while that if I want to try and identify a recent period, at that time, the best way I could define it was what I call the new global era, really from about 1990 almost to about, as it happens, 2008-2009, I'll get back to that, defines a very particular historical period. So that took me off on a strand, realizing that, to actually do a lot of work. And the key thing I realized, and the theme that underlies all of this, and you'll forgive me for the charts and the various pictures which don't have any buildings in them, is that, to me, it became very obvious that architecture and urban design were secondary or possibly tertiary activities after politics, economics, and social change. I mean, all architects suffer from hubris, and they actually believe that somehow they're going to change the world. Well, they can do in a limited way, but actually, in the end, that they will tend to follow, often with a delay, I have to say, for reasons I go into, they will tend to follow what the social, political, and economic trends are. And when I looked into it, I found, always retrospectively, of course, how remarkable the correspondences were. But you shouldn't think they're remarkable, because clearly, the world is the world, and architecture is a part of it, and it is going to be part of the way that things are driven. Not everything moves at the same speed, but that is just going to be the case. I was very surprised how little literature there was that looked at architecture in that way. So that's why I wrote the book. And incidentally, as I've still got a few spare copies, my normal procedure with this is, I presume there'll be questions after this. Yes. The person that most asked the most difficult, or the most interesting, question gets a signed hardback copy. The person that asked the second most interesting one, this is my choice entirely, gets a paperback copy. That's just to encourage you to think up. This is the payback for people when you're lecturing is the interesting questions. So, globalization, well, don't they spell it? Z or an S, I spell it with S. It sort of snuck up on everyone, really. It just turned up. But the thing about a lot of events is that they just happen. No one actually really quite planned them, they just happen. And this is one of the major events that just happened. And of course, when I started writing the book, lots of people came to me and said, when you write a book, you can't talk about anything else. They said, I hope you're going to be against it. I said, no, not really. My business in research is not to be against it, it's to understand it. It is a phenomenon, it's a major phenomenon, and you need to understand it. And that's what I tried to do. But there is a strong history of anti-globalization, which runs a sort of underneath. It was a quite an extreme activity for a long time. It's not so much now. And so, you know, here we get various demonstrations. In the top right, I always think United States, think globalization is just China. But of course, you know, we say it's in Europe, but actually the aspects of globalization are with us whether we like it or not. They snuck up on us. The internet, obviously increased communications, low-cost flights, clothing, even healthcare, even the distribution of medicines. All of these things are aspects of globalization. All of these things are things where we have just become very much better connected. And it happens. And in fact, I'm sure that the mixture of student body here would probably demonstrate that, much as my own office, where I employ 80 people, 40% of which are not British. I don't think about that. We didn't do it deliberately. It just happened. But of course, in architectural and urban design terms, one of the things that is most noticeable how is how everywhere looks the same. Now, this is a competition where I ask people if they know where these places are, even what continent they are. All right, group, you can put your hand down. you know one of them, don't you? But most people don't. Scruple is the exception, of course. Just to help you, I've provided the names. This is one of the things that people notice, particularly in architectural terms, how this has happened. I'll go into the detail of that in a moment. Although it is worth saying that I had to make sure you couldn't see the registration numbers on the automobiles, or the advertisements, because actually, and equally well, of course, the speech on the street. And you know, when you're an Instagram, you know that you can actually eat your meal off the street, it's so clean. It's not quite the same in Sao Paulo. There are other aspects in everyday life which are not the same. But however, it's a very strong impression that things are the same. And equally, and this is a cartoon I found on the internet, it took me a long time to track it down, is the idea somehow that all that is local and so on is being swept under the carpet. And these cartoons are always very good. It took me a long time to find. I found this on the internet without it being able to identify it. But of course, you can sort of identify the houses that have been swept under the carpet. I discovered it was Italian, as it happens. But maybe that's also a place where architects still wear white coats. That's broadly speaking where we are with globalization. Now, I'm afraid we go to history lessons now, because everything has a past. And there is going to be a future, and I'll get to that at the end. So the foundations of it, and I think this is very important, a lot of the foundations of it lie in the United States in the post-war period. Two major institutions, two major things effectively led to the World Bank and so on, was the Bretton Woods Agreement in 1944, where basically the post-war financial international order was really set in place, and the gold standard actually that collapsed in 1970, but nonetheless, it led to all of these financial institutions which are with us today. The United Nations is particularly interesting. Actually, that began in the United States. It began with a thing called the Atlantic Charter, which was a definition of the what, in fact, the Allied powers were fighting for during the war. It was a British-American agreement. They coined the expression United Nations before 1945. Another interesting aspect of the United Nations is that every single drafter of the United Nations, I've researched this quite carefully, although they were international, every single one of them, that part of their education in a North Atlantic educational institution. A lot of it reflects the American Declaration of Independence. It's a very, very strong North Atlantic character, which actually some of the dissenting countries sort of tend to notice. But a lot of these were really based on before the war. There's a 30s depression, trying to stop the 30s recession, and particularly the war itself. And of course, at the very bottom, we have Eleanor Roosevelt, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, now regarded as almost a religious document, in fact, objected to by the American Association of Anthropologists at the time as being Western orientated, the idea that an individual would have rights over and above the community in which they lived was actually a radical idea, which we now completely accept. And again, very much based on North Atlantic thinking. In fact, the Saudi Arabia and China didn't sign up because they actually simply didn't believe in the principle. So really, the post-war period was very much founded on, I call, North Atlantic culture, which by that time had become, basically Europe was totally crippled by the Second World War, became under American leadership. And as it happens at that time, a number of the Central European radical architects moved to the United States because they weren't very popular at home, and they had a very strong influence on architecture at that time. These two things correspond very closely. I think one has to realize that. The other thing that other aspects of this, which are in my book, you all go away and read now and buy, I'll sell more copies, and it is that, for example, the German, so the American Embassy program was specifically, they chose modernist architects to demonstrate the modernity of America. Conrad Hilton believed that building Hilton hotels was a means of persuading people in other countries not to become communists. Actually, for me, it would have been persuading me to become a communist, but there you go. But he was on a mission. And that the effect of this set the Cold War into motion. And so the leadership of the, we call it the free world, certainly the non-communist world, really was very clearly in the hands of the United States. There's not really a question about that. And there's a lot of, I can go on about that a lot, but it's reasonably clear to establish. But what actually then happened, with that leadership having taken place, was we entered what I call the key period, which is what I call it the new global era. It's an expression I made up. Because there were previous global eras. The era from about 1890 to 1914 was when a lot of international treaties were created, a lot of international standards were created, huge movement of people and so on. That broke down with the First World War. But the new global era was characterized by three things. One was the collapse of the Soviet Union, the Soviet Empire, and effectively the Soviet economy entered the free market system. And the reopening of the Shanghai Stock Exchange, this is in a very short period of time, and the liberalization of Indian financial markets. All of these things happened within about a 2 to 3 year period. And so suddenly, from effectively the free movement of capital, or reasonably free movement of capital, being contained within the North Atlantic countries, large under the domination of the United States, actually you got free movement of capital throughout the world. The effect of this is quite dramatic. And everyone realized it at the time. Here are some interesting quotations. I won't read them out because you can all read. Reading off the screen is boring. But, I just picked Anatoly Chubais is actually not, it was not Vladimir Putin, but I couldn't find Vladimir Putin saying it. There you go. The idea that the globalization was an inexhaustible center of strength for social purpose and so on, coming actually from China at the time. Quite a famous speech that Bill Clinton made speaking of it like a natural phenomenon. So everyone agreed that this was something that was important and was happening. I'll return to these three countries again at the end. And of course, the impact of this is what is generally called homogenization. Nice big word. So everything pretty much the same, just in case one doesn't know what it means. One of the reasons for this is that, of course, effectively, the free movement of capital created a demand-based economy and was largely driven by consumerism. And all of that was already extremely well established in the North Atlantic countries, in particular the United States. The power of branding. A number of these are, in fact, I think the only one that isn't is Mercedes-Benz, but nonetheless, a lot of these came to the United States or the North Atlantic countries. So these are extremely extremely advanced corporations in the consumer economy. And we take these things for granted. Not quite, actually. Starbucks had a problem in the Forbidden City in China. It's the interesting aspect of logos. Is that they didn't like, there was a television campaign, they didn't like Starbucks logo in the Forbidden City. So there's a big fuss about it. And they said, well, you can stay there, but you've got to take the logo off. And they said, well, no, we can't be there without the logo, so they left. I mean, it's quite interesting, sort of little case study. But it's these sort of things, they're sort of with us in ways that we don't, this modulated, which we don't often realize. The obvious things like brands, and if you want to be anti-globalization, you trash a McDonald's. And there was a, French farmers keep doing it, in spite of the fact their franchises are owned by French people anyway. It's just a great symbol. But actually, there's other things going on. I mean, why is it, this is the G20, why is it that they're all wearing suits rather like I'm wearing? With one or two exceptions, the foreign minister of Kuwait, I think, Madame Botox Kirchner there, and Angela Merkel is kind of wearing one anyway. Is the reason they're wearing them is because of this man, bottom right, is Beau Brummel, who invented the three-piece suit and invented it at a time when Britain was by far the most powerful economy in the world. So this is a symbol of belonging to this club of global finance, of global economies. And it's interesting that there's all sorts of other examples that one can bring up. Why in China do people wear, at universities, wear a version of a 17th century clerical clothing when they get a degree? I mean, it's bizarre, but I mean, I can go on about it. But these are good. The other good example, just things we're in the United States, to move the point, is why is it, does everyone wear American working men's, 19th century working men's clothes? Well, the reason is, in the bottom right, is the absolute dominance of American popular culture in the post-war period. But no one thinks about it, no one really thinks about it. But these are all aspects of how things basically became the same. And you get it in architecture too, of course. This is an advertisement which I tore out of a flight magazine. I'm an annoying person because it was an internal engine flight, doesn't matter. Talking about it being a world standard. Actually, it is a world standard everywhere in the world. And here we have, this is Richard Rogers, and it's actually two British architects producing stuff, one in Barcelona and another in Guangzhou. I mean, this is normal stuff. So that's all part of that same phenomenon. And this goes with global capital as well. These are, I mean, there are lots of charts like this, but these are two that I've used. One is the movement of global capital. You can see its rise over the period, really, from the beginning of that period right through when I was finishing this research in 2006. And a similar one is internet hosts. I mean, there are lots of versions of this, but the pattern is reasonably consistent. And interestingly, symbolically, going back to the point, is the home of global capital is downtown Manhattan. You know, that and Wall Street, that is symbolically the home. And just to make sure everyone understands that, these are two advertisements. One is from the Financial Times, and the other is from Emirates Bank. And they're actually made up of global iconic buildings. But you notice the sort of similarity, look across the water, to downtown Manhattan. I tried to get a copy of the Financial Times one to use in the book, but they're going to charge me about £300, so I said, forget it. I just tore a page out of a magazine, and I contacted the Emirates Bank a couple of times. They never replied, so I used it. when I was on the phone to the Financial Times trying to persuade them to give it to me, they said, oh, lots of people contact us about this and ask us where it is. So at Equal, there's World Trade Centers around the world. All those World Trade Centers, interestingly enough, often have the symbol, still have the symbol of the Twin Towers, funnily enough. And that was the great symbol. And they're all spelt, the center is all spelt the American way, too. But again, you can follow this through to global architectural practice. Here are the previous two charts, and here is a chart of the growth of global practice over the same period. I mean, it's divided up. I mean, it's slightly complicated, and if you buy the book, you can read it more easily. But We'll stop saying that. you can see the growth pattern is very, very similar. As you would expect, I mean, if architecture urban design really do follow these phenomena, you would expect this. This is quite reasonable. And the other, this one did surprise me when I researched it, and I'll get back to this diagram in a minute, is that I then looked into the numbers of the way that these global practices are defined is by any architectural practice that has a branch office in another global region. The global regions are quite clearly defined. I had trouble getting information out of some of them. The Italian one had refused to tell me. I can't think why. So I rang up their office in North Africa, and so I was a client. And could you actually tell me how many people you've got in your office? And they told me straight away. It's interesting how the Anglophone countries, United States, United Kingdom, and Australia for that matter, and even Ireland, and even Hong Kong practices are actually, both of them, the two in that case, were founded in the British colonial period, to what extent they dominate. That surprised me, actually. I really hadn't expected to be quite that clear cut, along with the other aspects of global practice. And of course, this leads to global architecture, and I dealt with this earlier, but we're familiar. These buildings are, you know, this is the standard glass-walled office block. I mean, they're pretty unsatisfactory environmentally in temperate countries, but actually they're completely bonkers in places, you know, like Saudi Arabia and Mumbai. You know, it's mad. But that doesn't matter. What matters is they are symbols of corporate success. This is how you symbolize corporate success. That's what they are. They're big symbols. Other aspects of this, which got traced through, this is Hans Eblings, who identified this phenomenon called supermodernity, where basically it doesn't matter what you use the building for, it looks pretty much the same. You really can't identify the hotel industry. It's not actually a hotel, it's a sort of business kind of building. And then there's a museum of art. I mean, we're familiar with this. So basically, you cover it in glass, give it a plain front, and stick what you want in it. Now, actually, you cover it in glass, put something funny on top of the glass, and put what you want in it. The principle is pretty much the same. What's interesting, actually, is that the predominance of these buildings, they are for global functions. I mean, the corporate office, global hotels, you know, the famous thing about the businessman that goes to an airport, gets it looks familiar, goes in an airplane, that's pretty much the same. Right, another airport, which is pretty much like the one he was in before. He gets in a taxi, doesn't speak to the taxi driver, gets a hotel, just like the hotel he has at home, and vice versa. And everyone says, well, his wife rings him up and says, where are you? I said, not really, but sure. That's a common joke. But it's interesting that a lot of these buildings are, there's the shopping malls, you know, the expression of consumerism, airports, and there's also golf clubs. Golf clubs are a bit of an outrider in this one, actually, because they're often meant to look like Scottish baronial houses, but you know, there you go, right. Can't be right every time. So all of these things fit together, and one particular aspect of it, which is interesting, I think possibly is coming to an end for a very particular reason, is the what's happened with global capital. Think about global capital, it doesn't go anywhere. Now you've got free movement of capital. If you want to have headquarters, you can indulge in what is called regulatory arbitrage. You can have a look around the globe and say, right, where charges me least tax? You know, where is the most pleasant place to live? You know, where would I like my chief executives to go? And they say they won't resign and go somewhere else. And so what happens is cities now compete for the attraction of global capital. Often distinct from their countries. I mean, you know, actually cities become drive it themselves. So their billboards, their big advertising, their branding became, particularly after this building, became iconic buildings. And the Bilbao case is particularly interesting because it had received a lot of money from the European Union. The Guggenheim, basically a globalizing American organization, touted itself around Europe and said, "Yeah, we're going to build one. Where do you want it?" And Bilbao offered them the most money. They then went to an international selection process, which was going to get an international architect. They chose Frank Gehry. Interestingly enough, who at that stage was not an international architect. He is now, of course. The only international building is at the Vitra factory in Germany, which is an architectural zoo anyway. But it's interesting, so that was the expenditure of American capital, the introduction of an American architect to produce what was really the first of its kind iconic buildings. Interesting enough, the brief for it was to be like Sydney Opera House, the previous one. That was actually in the brief. The key to this was that Bilbao, basically a Spanish rust belt thing in the Basque region, it spent a huge amount of money on upgrading its infrastructure and other buildings, but this was the icing on the cake. And they published a thing called the Bilbao effect, which demonstrated, apparently, that this building brought in a huge amount of money to Bilbao. It probably didn't, it probably the rest of it as well, but nonetheless, in the 2 or 3 years after that, most of the major iconic buildings were commissioned. They take so long to build, and so they occasionally just give up, like the one in Galicia. The Eisenhower one, they just stopped, you know, because they can't afford it anymore. They're commissioned in this period. They all wanted to cash in on the Bilbao effect. It's a very specific aspect of global culture. And of course, you know, there are other ones here. This is the Burj Khalifa. Interesting enough, was that hit the recession because it was going to be the Burj Dubai, but it went up in the Burj Khalifa, which is the Abu Dhabi royal family, who had to bail them out, which is the ultimate humiliation. The thing about these the tall buildings is they're fundamentally uneconomic, you know, because the cost of getting the infrastructure up to the top is so great, it's actually their tallness is the only thing that makes them economic. And here is one of the reasons why Spain actually completely collapsed, and they commissioned lots of these things. And they're currently suing Santiago Cathedral because they all leak. But that's another story. So this iconic building is in a way a product of that global economy. And along with it, of course, is the star architect. There always were star architects. The first one actually was the most woman in way, Danny Liebskind, who actually straddles this period very nicely. It took forever to do. It's the Jewish Museum, which was actually empty for a bit just so you could appreciate the building more than the exhibits. And that is a common Liebskind thing, is that building's a work of art on its own. But of course, many others followed. This is Rem Koolhaas's Central China Television. Just how you know, this is a propaganda machine for China, in fact. Although Rem Koolhaas said it addresses the people because there's the footpath running below it. I thought, well, okay, you know, Rem, that's pretty convincing. Rem Koolhaas has said that he can't actually control how these are used in terms of symbolism, but in fact China Television adopted this strange shape as part of its logo at one stage. Interesting, I mean, it just shows the significance of these things. Then of course, with them comes the global architect. I mean, I would never wish it anybody, because unfortunately Paul Zahadi died, but in fact her death probably to some extent symbolizes the end of the period. I'll get back to that later, because I think there's a much more powerful symbol than that, which I'll forget, please remind me. And the power of this, I mean, eventually real estate recognized the power of these global names. This building is called New York by Gehry. I didn't realize New York was made by Gehry, but never mind. clearly, Gehry is so famous that actually he made New York, and just to make sure everyone understood it, he put up a building. And this is sold as Nouvelle Chelsea. Well, you know, Jean Nouvelle, not New Chelsea. But, you know, this is done for good commercial reasons, because they actually believe these could sell rather better. And this is a phenomenon that's still with us, but I think it's ending. I think the other thing is global urbanism. The idea, global urbanism tied up with the global architecture, one of the things it does is try and make sure you can see the buildings. So to see the buildings, you've got to give them lots and lots of space, and you've got a really wide streets. This is you know, fairly universal stuff in the States of America. It's not great, frankly, when it's built. You also get the star architect, who, for some reason, if you're a star architect, it means you can be an urban designer. I think everyone knows, all the students here know, that being a good architect doesn't automatically make you a good urban designer. They are not distinct, but they certainly have their different aspects and disciplines. And of course, you know, Danny Liebskind obviously forgotten the 1970s, but he's old enough to know about them, and what happened with tall buildings in big parks. That doesn't matter, because he's an important architect. And here we have Zaha Hadid doing the same thing. The interesting thing one at the bottom, and I think this is actually where a story about it helps. This is a competition for Kartal, which is an urban suburb or a satellite town of Istanbul, which is really declines very severely, so much so that the life expectancy of a mayor is something like 2 to 3 years. And that's not because they die of food poisoning or anything. They actually get shot. They put out this competition, and actually this is a three-dimensional one. These buildings actually go up and down, like a sort of pipe organ. And they chose Zaha Hadid. I know other people that entered this competition and were sort of bitter and twisted about this. But they chose it. They said, if we give it to Zaha Hadid, it will put Kartal on the map. And they were right. I'm talking about it. I mean, they were never going to build this ever. I mean, this is, you know, this is a complete space fiction fantasy. So the power of actually the star architect was such that even getting to win something that they weren't going to build was considered to be enough. So all of this is part of the homogenizing aspect of globalization. Now, one of the things about it is, and I think this will take us through eventually to today, is that what happens in parallel with this is this homogenization, is localization. Now, these are two sides of the same coin. Let me be clear about this. I'm sorry, I'm going to get very historical now. Because I'm going back to world political structure. I have to go back to 1648 and the Treaties of Westphalia. So I was back in the Second World War before, but I've gone back a bit further. This was the time when it was decided that the state, as we know it, could be the state. In other words, basically, a state could wage war with another state, could decide on the religion of its citizens. By the way, the Roman Catholic Church really hated this. They objected to it because the Roman Catholic Church, of course, being what it is a global organization. The idea that you know, some states in northern Germany could choose their own religion was really not what they wanted. But nonetheless, the whole idea that a state could do what it wanted within its own constraints, this was established at the end of the religious wars. But at that time, a state was really defined by its monarch and its subsets of its monarch. So that was how it was. But then certain things happened. One was the American Declaration of Independence, who basically decided they weren't going to have a king anymore, and the French who decided they cut his head off. A lot of the institutions of the global state were actually invented in after the French Revolution. So from that moment, you weren't loyal to a person, you were loyal to an abstract identity, which was a state. So it wasn't a person, it was a state. So here we have Marianne, you know, the symbol of the French state. Actually, that's to do with the Spring of Nations, the whole series of revolutions in 1848. But this is also the time of the Industrial Revolution. So not only had to be loyal to that, one of the reasons you had to be loyal to an abstract state was you had a loyal army, because a big army meant you were, you know, you could do better than the next state. And you also had to control your industry, and you had to control your economy. And so being big was important. So you tended to absorb other states if you could, either by defeat or, you know, Germany was created at this time, Italy was created at this time. Or also you suppressed ethnic or cultural groups. I mean, France, up to quite recently in its constitution, said you could not use any other language other than, you know, French as a side of Academy Française. So in the Basque era, you were not allowed to call your children Basque names. So the idea that a state was a solid group which demanded loyalty to an abstract idea of the state is actually only dates back to this period. Now, what happened as we get to the movement of global capital and the period where I call the new global era is that actually you don't really wage war against other states, unless the United States, in which case you do, but generally speaking you don't, because you get blown up. You can't control your economies. There's no country in the world now that actually produces all its military material within its borders. And you can't control your economy. Basically, the economy is closed. You can try and control your economy, but while you have free movement of capital, of course, as everyone objects to now, we're going to, is the fact that other people can lower their taxes and they can go somewhere else. or they can lower their labour rates and they can go somewhere else, it's a topical subject. Interestingly, very quickly, this started to unpick states. Of course, we had the classic one was the breakup of the Soviet Union. But also, other things happened. The Indian constitution was modified to give more regional power about the same time. Canada created Nunavut, which was an Inuit, with a large Inuit population, was given much more independence. And you get all sorts of independence movements, which I'll get back to. This is the Padania. This is supposed to be the North Italian state, which really wants to cut itself off from those idle, time-wasting, corrupt southern Italians. This has become a fairly widespread phenomenon. Scotland, I mean, people think like marching on these occasions, Scotland has had a go and failed, and it might have another go until eventually it gets the referendum right. It's probably not going to, actually, but it was a very serious attempt. One of the first ethnic groups he recognised as independent, interesting enough, were the Sami, the North Scandinavian group, otherwise known as Lapp, we call them Tender Lapp, the Sami, who created their own parliament, because they ranged across the north of Sweden, Norway, Finland, and Russia, as an ethnic group specifically identified as having some specific identity. Bavarians then didn't bother because it's the Kingdom of Bavaria anyway. October the 1st currently the Spanish government is doing everything it can to stop Catalonia having a referendum, which is only merely inspiring more and more Catalonians to have the idea that they might become independent. This is a crisis happening now. Yeah. Conveniently written in English, actually. the power of the English language, you hear about it, actually, you look at those Catalonian demonstrations, of course, particularly in the United States and Britain, you notice they do focus on banners which are half written in English and half in Catalan, definitely not in Castilian. And town hall in Madrid, they have a thing in English, a big banner saying "Welcome to refugees." And clearly, refugees can't speak Spanish. Anyway, that's just the power of the English language. So it's interesting how quickly the state started to unpick when the raison d'être of the state started to disappear. Now, what was the architectural response to this? Well, there's going to be an architectural response, and there are various aspects to it. One is the understanding that identity was important as a concept of marginalisation. One response was the abstract version, which is, provided it was different, it was identifiable, therefore it was okay. So you could put a big Emmental cheese in the middle of Dublin. Interestingly enough, the architects there said they asked the local people what they wanted, and they told them they wanted something traditional. They said, well, we weren't going to give them that. This is actually in a city called Leicester in England, where they produced lace once upon a time, so they got a big bit of lace and blew it up and put it on a glass wall. Because they had to have a glass wall. The other one is critical regionalism, which actually really goes back to Kenneth Frampton in 1983 in an anti-postmodern lecture, which he couldn't really identify what was critically regional, except for things like it followed the site contours, which is pretty weak, really. But the title, which is also originally thought up by, I think, Alexander Turnus in The Affair, but the title was so attractive that people attach themselves to this consistently now. I don't think anyone read Kenneth Frampton's lecture, actually, but I'm afraid that critical regionalism sounds good. So here's Ken Yang in Kuala Lumpur saying it's critically regional because it's got local plants in it. Alison Brooks, who said it's critically regional because in this area they use timber on buildings, so I am too. I'm afraid that it may sound fine, it's quite serious. These people have told me this. So I'm not lying. It just sounds funny. And of course, it's stuff that I do. Actually, this is not about my buildings, but I thought I had to put at least two of mine in just in case I forgot who was giving the lecture. And of course, traditionalism, which in a way is a product of the sort of surviving bit of postmodernism. People don't like that. We were the people who took it seriously. Because we actually have conviction and integrity, it's actually survived and continues. And it is a strong movement. The thing where actually local things never went away was the suburb. I didn't do that suburban house, by the way. And this universal idea that you have a sort of shorthand version of what's local, if you go to the outskirts of Moscow, you'll find sort of Russian-ish mansions. That's something that never really quite went away. So there's this, what's happening, you get global homogenization, but at the same time, aspects of that homogenization release localization. So effectively, there's always a slight tug of war between those two things. And that's often, I believe, not recognized. In terms of urban design, as non-place, Marc Auger was one of the people, sociologists, who coined this term. I mean, everyone recognized, actually, really, that you couldn't really tell where these places were. This one's got a London taxi in it, so you can't tell. That's Dubai Airport. Well, if you look closely at the Fritz on the glass, you can tell it's not actually in Britain or America. But it actually looks like every airport anywhere else. And the reaction to this is interesting. If you start to look at it, you start to look at the dates of these organizations. They do pretty much correspond with the beginning of the global era. The first one actually was a Vision of Europe, which is sort of withered on the vine a bit. Vision of Europe was a deliberate reference to Prince of Wales' Vision of Britain. The CEU, 1994, INVA, which I helped to found in 2000, CEU, which I also helped to found in 2003, the Academy of Boasting, I'm involved with the bottom threes, it happens. But all of these organizations took place, these were organizations that recognized, which is actually blindingly obvious when you get to it, is that places on the top, and that's Birmingham in England, are not nearly as nice to live in as places at the bottom. I mean, you had to do this to find it out, and they found it out, and you know, everyone pretty much recognized this. And you know, you by certain kinds of architects, you know pretty much where you are. And this is generally quite well recognized. And obviously one of the most important of the first attempts at this was Seaside in Florida, extremely important in its way. Sort of redneck Riviera holiday town, but nonetheless, it was very important. And the Prince of Wales went to see it, and Leon Creer was involved with it, or I think he still owed money. is Poundbury, which has been very influential. Interesting enough, the architectural profession could barely speak about this without spitting when it was introduced. They now think that actually the evidence is pretty good. Pity about the buildings. But it is extremely important, still being built. And just so in case you forgot, I was an urbanist, there's one that I did. That's in Edinburgh. But I think the important thing about this urban movement is actually it's much more widespread than we imagine. I call it contextual urbanism. I mean, we don't call it new urbanism in Britain, it's called traditional urbanism, it's called new urbanism in the States. It's about context, I call it contextual urbanism. And this is Malmö in Sweden. This is a modernist version, complete with a kind of Trafford Tower. But actually the same basic principles are at play here. And to some extent, the urban battle has been won. I mean, you know, a lot of institutions are now teaching them, organizations in Britain, the kind of urbanism. It's a pretty, there are shades of it, and there are bits of it, and there are bits that are not, you know, different. But it's effectively, if you go to somewhere like Ren Koolhaas's website, you will find a description of what an urban design should be like, which sounds remarkably familiar until you see the buildings. I went to a lecture by Norman Foster's office in Libya before the Civil War, and I could have given that lecture until I saw what they did. So actually, the ideas behind it have become pretty well accepted. This is a very strong aspect of localization during this period. But, I think it's important, as I was writing the book, you know, it all came to an end. it wasn't a drag, really, because it meant absolutely it was a terminus post-quem for the whole thing. So that was good, you know. It actually identified an era which had come to an end. And it kind of did, and obviously it's the collapse of the collapse of 2008. I mean, my book was published in 2012. I actually was finishing it off as the effects of this became evident. I mean, it was a huge financial shock, as we all know. I mean, I don't know the details, But of course, you know, it was the banks that were blamed, and not without good reason, actually. Really, that ended, that really, well, I'll get into the reasons of how this ended and what happened. So I think the impact of it is particularly interesting. And something with which we're in today. We're in the rebound from this. And what we have, these are the covers from The Economist, they released particularly good covers, is that the BRICS, the Brazil, Russia, India and China, and they keep extending it, these rapidly advancing economies started to slow down. Here are the great deceleration. India and China actually in particular, and Brazil as well actually. India, Russia, or China is a different story. What we then have, but what happened actually in that intervening period, we're talking about 10, 15 years, is that things have shifted. And you can start to look at what the shift was. Even at the end of this period, you start to re-examine it. What I call the New World Order. Now, this is global real estate investment, which is interesting. This is countries investing in real estate abroad. As you would expect, the USA is pretty high, but look at China. Significant part is Hong Kong, I'd say, but which is part of China. A lot of people in Hong Kong don't think it is anymore, but Chinese still think it is. And also the other thing is I'll come back to this, you're beginning to get a very widespread.
Investment buy or investment in?
Sorry, this is investment out. And I tried to do a comparative chart for the one I'd done previously on global international firms. The USA and the UK are still up there, but what's interesting is that the chart is spread horizontally. Now, this is obviously a beginning of a shifting pattern. So we don't get that absolute concentration on those few Anglophone countries. Now, this is the beginning of a trend, but nonetheless, that's what it demonstrated, So we have Denmark, Vietnam, Bahrain, Spain, all with global practices. And this is the chart that frightens everyone in this country. There are various versions of this, and the Chinese. This is the comparative GDP and GDP per capita USA China. This is a projection, and of course, the trouble with projections is they're never really true. But nonetheless, it's one of many projections. There's another one which I saw recently about international power base, and actually the time span to where China got to is actually much shorter than this. But I think you also have to look at gross domestic product, in other words, the totality of the national economy related to per capita, and China's still got a long way to go. Although China is very interested now in its own consumer economy, because that's what effectively it needs to have to replace its industrial economy, its exporting economy. But nonetheless, this is a wake-up call. And of course, it's a wake-up call, particularly in the country I'm in now, because it should be in Europe, but it isn't, because Europe is now disregarded by the Chinese as a failing peninsula of the Asian continent. But or as Americans call it, creating the best retirement home in the world. This is the emerging new world order. So the United States, which really, and still is, but to a significant extent, had been absolutely the dominant power in every way, that is now shifting, slowly but shifting. An interesting article recently about Chinese entrepreneurs. The story was rather like Japan after the Second World War. Oh, they're just copying. They're not really innovative. Actually, that's now changing. Some of the most significant internet product productions are coming from China. So this is an emerging pattern. And then, of course, look at China. A lot of people in China. China is pretty much the size of Europe. And, of course, China has had a very specific policy of introducing foreign architects. They wanted foreign architects. They had quotas. Some cities had quotas for foreign architects. And this symbol in Nanjing is a drum tower and an SOM building. Sums it up quite nicely. But indeed, there's this image. Remember this image? This is another version of, this is Pudong, Constructed since about 1990, it's amazing. Constructed since about then. Interesting enough, it had a quota, actually the Beijing Central District, not this, this is Shanghai, had a quota of tower blocks they were going to have. And I just did a count of the downtown tower blocks in Manhattan, because the people publish these things. And it was the same number as a quota for the Central Business District in Beijing. That may be a coincidence. But just in case there's any misunderstanding about how China thinks about it, thought about its global position, that's a huge, if you've ever been to Shanghai and Pudong, every night this thing lights up. I mean, you recognize it, just as the last two letters aren't the same. And in case you're really not sure, go to the Bund, the sort of former European area there, and on there is this, the Bund Bull, which is the same by the famous sculptures, also credit the Wall Street Charging Bull. And so just conveniently written in English as well as Chinese, just in case you missed the point. And China had a policy for a while of making all of its buildings slightly Chinese. But all people did was stick pagodas on top of glass walled office blocks, and everyone laughed, and so they stopped doing it. So now, actually, they have employed global architects to produce global buildings. The symbolism of this we've already discussed. But of course, China, as indeed in India, are quite eclectic in a way, because actually, modernism is culturally embedded in North European countries, North Atlantic countries, and North European countries. So if you get a building, you kind of know that's what you're going to get. If you want a building in China or India, or for that matter, the Middle East, you have to explain why you've got it. So actually, there's not this automatic, this isn't automatically what you're going to get. I'll return to that. And the other thing you get, and we forget, is one of our most successful exports in the North Atlantic countries, the suburbs. Much as all of those who are involved with, contextual urbanism really hate it, I'm afraid it is an extremely successful export. And there's not much to beat having your own house in your own lot where you can park your own car and nobody else can come in. And you don't have to hear people having parties next door. I'm afraid it's extremely successful. India, situated broadly similar, the top there is in Kerala. There's this attempt to produce something regional, but at the same time is modern. But Infosys, the big computing company, really wants to show that it is a global company, and it does it with its campus, which is deliberately not Indian. And of course, you get the suburb here. This is another one. This is actually in Kerala, complete with a running track and a sort of slightly Indianized mansion. So in this new but if actually this is the new global order, what's happening architecturally? That's a difficult thing to pin down, because if you've got all this stuff happening, as people in China wanting global architecture, therefore wanting North Atlantic architecture, what kind of impact is it going to have? Well, I'm guessing now, but I'm going to introduce one of my pet theories, so bear with me. I made this up, by the way. It sounds impressive. But I made up for good reason. In fact, my sociologist friends told me that no one else has thought of it, so I'm very proud of this. I'll now tell you what it is. It's a phenomenon coming from one country, being exported to another country, then going back to its country of origin as modified. And I'll explain a bit. Halloween, interesting enough. In England, Halloween was banned in the 17th century. It wasn't banned in Scotland, ironically, though Scotland was a fiercely Protestant country, and it wasn't banned in Ireland. So Halloween was taken to the United States by people of Scottish and Irish origin and turned into a very big thing. Now, my family is Scottish. I celebrated Halloween as a child. Nobody knew what it was in England. They thought we were mad. It was very close to Guy Fawkes Night, which was really, we substituted, in England, we substituted Halloween for burning a Roman Catholic day. Because Guy Fawkes was a Roman Catholic who tried to kill the king. But what happened was then, relatively recently, Halloween came back to England in its American form. And now we hollow out pumpkins. We hollowed out turnips, and believe me, pumpkins are much better. So much softer. So that's come back. It's come from something. It's gone somewhere. The Bar Mitzvah is an interesting one. Originally a Middle European Jewish ceremony of originally medieval, mostly a family affair, taken to the United States and turned into a big event. And of course, reformers turned to go, and got the Bat Mitzvah as well. And it went back to the European Jewish community as another big ceremony. So that's another case in point. My favorite one is Bhangra Rock, Punjabi folk music, taken by Punjabi immigrants in Britain and turned into rock music form and taken back to India. Now, incredibly popular. All weddings play Bhangra Rock. And most rock concerts, certainly in Britain, have Bhangra Rock sections in them. That's another example. But if we want to get architectural about it, which of course we have to, because that's why I'm here, if we want to get classical about it, well, we can do that as well. Of course, we know that the classical orders were originally tribal. They were Dorian tribe, Ionian tribe. But what happened was that King Antiochus IV, in the second century BC, when Roman power was expanding, when he was a crown prince, effectively, the Romans took him as a hostage. I mean, they didn't lock him in a cell, he had pretty good tact. But they kept him, he became Romanized. And when he became the king, he realized that actually he just had to say boo and the Romans would walk in and get rid of him. So clearly he had to do the right things. And one of the first things he did was that the Temple of Zeus in Athens, which is constantly being rebuilt, he hired a Roman architect who built it in the Corinthian order. This is the first significant Corinthian building in Greece. So you have the classical orders taken from Greece to some extent, Magna Graecia, taken by the Romans, aspects of it taken and developed in the Corinthian order, taken back to Greece. And we don't have to stick to classicism, we can do it with modernism too. I mean, modernism started to a significant extent as a social reforming movement. Very closely tied up with communism and tied up with other social reforming movements. One of the reasons that the right-wing parties kicked it out in the 1930s. And it came to the United States. Well, the United States didn't want any nasty communists doing their buildings, so they turned into a commercial phenomenon, much more commercial phenomenon, in which form it was taken back to Europe. This actually is the first tall building in Berlin after the war. So that's it. So taken a socially reforming thing, taken away, turned into a commercial phenomenon, and then taken back to its country of origin. Interestingly, this is still the problem when you get modernist architects who spout all that social, you know, social responsibly rhetoric and produce unbelievably socially responsible buildings. They're still locked into this dilemma, is that they know that the history of what they're doing is all about social reform, but they know that actually they're just building commercial stuff for rich people. The other thing, I think, the thing that's interesting, I get back to my point about China, is one thing I think has been a significant change. I'm not entirely speculating on this, is that if you're trying to sell a building, as I said, in Europe and in North America, or for that matter, in South America, you don't say, I'm producing a modernist building because, you just produce a modernist building. Nobody says why, you just do it, because it's culturally embedded. This is not true elsewhere. So if you are trying to sell your building, you've got to think of another reason. And it's not just because you're a rather smart North American architect, although that does help. What you do is you sell as a metaphor. So the Gazprom building is a gas flame. A surprise. It's a gas company, so their building is a gas flame. The Bertinelli Beach Aquarium, it's an aquarium, but it looks like a series of rocks washed up against the lake. So. And it's got these, of course, are sold in countries where, you know, there is no automatic switch to modernism. But it sort of comes back to I mean, and so, for example, if your name was Norman Foster, and believe me, I know it's not, and you were in 15 years ago, you said, well, I've done this building, as an audience like this, you're all students, and not all of you, and I said, I'm reducing this building because it looks like a ding jar. You'll think, oh, come on, Norman, you know, what happened to high tech? But now he does, because it's in China. You can actually say that I'm producing a building that looks like a jar, you know, like an antique jar, because it's Chinese. So this idea of metaphor, which has always been there, has actually become very much stronger. The arch case is the Scottish Parliament Bill, Eric Morales, where it's full of metaphors which nobody really understands, only Eric Morales. Those bizarre hammer-shaped things are actually supposed to be a symbol of a well-known painting called The Skating Minister, but unfortunately Morales died and forgot to tell anybody, and so the Scottish people call them hairdryers. And Enric Morales and Benita Taibabue, his partner, went around Scotland and they decided to have a three-week tour to discover what Scottish identity was. Pretty quick, really. They decided that Scottish identity was building boats in towns and going away. Well, Scottish people didn't think that, but it doesn't matter. Enric Morales was a genius. So he's designed a parliament where you make decisions in upturned boats and go away. Okay. That was his metaphor. So that's quite a subtle shift. So in that new world order, things have shifted a bit. But architecture is a very, very slow-moving phenomenon. Architects basically, present company accepted, stop thinking when they leave college mostly, and they take to at least 40 and probably 50 until they get to designing big buildings, which get, and buildings take about 5 or 10 years to produce. So by the time you've actually got the building up, you're about 20 years out of date anyway. So it's all fairly slow moving. So, but nonetheless, it does behove us. If the principle is correct, which I believe it to be, that architecture does follow social, political, and economic phenomena, we are now entering a new period. I don't see any doubt about that. And everyone knows that. And I'll get into that in a minute and probably offend everybody when I start talking about politics, but never mind. I'm British, I can do that. We should have a look at the situation now. We can speculate and see. And I think more than speculate, actually. I think we're in a time of great change. And the thing is, in times of great change, is small things make a big difference. When everything's static, like great global period, you really couldn't shift anything much because everyone was happy. If it's dead, all fine. And why rock the boat? Well, it's not like that now. And if we want a reasonable economic picture of what's now called populism, this is what's called the elephant curve, produced by the World Bank, Christopher Lackner and Branko Milanovic. And just to explain this, that the x-axis is percentile of global income distribution. So here we are, the poorest countries at the far end, if you like, and the richest countries at the other end. And the y-axis is the growth in income in the same period. I'm sorry, I like these charts, but I have to explain them. So you can see, and that's the person who actually produced this one conveniently put some labels on it. You can see that the very poorest countries, mostly in Africa, are locked out of growth. But actually, when you look at the emerging economies, their growth has been absolutely huge. When you look at the established economies, the rich economies, the richest people have got an awful lot richer, and the sort of middle range have either been static or got poorer. So if you really want an economic view of where populism came from, this is a useful diagram. The idea that, a rising tide lifts up all the boats isn't quite right. So clearly some of the boats have too short of tenders and they got stuck. And another version is this, where the x-axis, horizontal axis, is the GDP per person, the percentage of change, and how much GDP per person. This is balanced by a thing called purchasing power parity. So it's what the economists call the McDonald's factor, how much the McDonald's costs in each country. It's not the one they use. But obviously you've got to balance it. And the vertical, the y-axis, is globalization is a force for good, percentage agreeing. And you can see that the countries with the largest chip income, they feel very positively about globalization on a national basis. And you can see the United States sits in this. So in one sense you have national attitudes, in the other sense you have, particularly in the developed countries, you get the benefits are not always that great. As a result of this, you get what is very significant. I'm sorry about that picture of Donald Trump. I chose that one particularly. It's a much nicer one later. I chose a California Republic. The last one I wanted to see was Texas, but I think they stopped now. I mean, California is the next one. But nonetheless, what we have is the Wilders, the Freedom Party in Holland, Front National, UKIP, which actually is behind the scenes largely responsible for the British desire to leave. You've got the True Finns Party at the top, like the Finnish Party. You've got Lega Nord, who wants to create Padania. You can add to that Podemos in Spain, Cinque Stelle in Italy, Syriza in Greece, or even take Viktor Orban in Hungary, who's actually in power. So all of these, this is obviously a very significant phenomenon. All these parties don't get into power. I identified Donald Trump. I'm not sure anymore if he's Republican or Democrat. I think that he's actually just Donald Trump. But the general feeling is that he actually represents a populist surge. I mean, that fits with the general picture. That's why I've included, I had the Tea Party in there before. But I mean, the United States actually invented the word populism, a very long history of it, from Huey Long to Ross Perot and Pat Buchanan. And equally well, the 99% movement, the Occupy movement. These are all part of, broadly speaking, the same phenomenon. This is, you know, we can like this or not, but it's a phenomenon. I mean, I find certain aspects of it deeply distasteful personally. But I think you ignore a phenomenon at your peril. Interesting thing is that a lot of these parties, like the UKIP party in Britain, it doesn't have a single member of parliament. It did have one, but he gave up. But they were able to influence government policy. And Geert Wilders is the same in Holland. And different electoral systems can have different impacts. You know, the state election system, presidential election system in the United States meant that the person that won the popular vote didn't get it. The referendum in Britain, where no one can hide behind an electoral system, it's either is or it isn't. Front National, the French system, is very good at eliminating third parties because their runoff system. They're all slightly different. But nonetheless, this is all powerful stuff. Interestingly, there's a book we produced recently, which it sums this up quite interestingly. I'll read you a passage from it. Actually, it's a British book. It's called The Road to Somewhere, by a commentator called David Goodhart. And basically, he divides the group up. This is a very crude division. He makes it much more subtle. Into somewheres and anywheres. And I'll read you what he says about anywheres. And the most typical anywhere is a liberally inclined graduate. Familiar? They're mainly in the upper quartile of income and social class spectrum, and they predominate among decision makers and opinion formers. The average somewhere is on a middling income. They're most likely to be the bottom three quartiles of the income and social class spectrum, and not in the main experience higher education. People from somewhere are numerically much larger and more widely described than anywheres, but their political voice is weaker, unless it's a referendum. Quite a useful definition, because all sorts of other factors come to bear, which you don't realize, is that, for example, internal migration, how far people move from home. Remarkably few people move that far from home. It's quite surprising. In the United States, I think it's 5 to 6% move across county borders and 1.3% move state. It's very, very low per annum. In the UK, the indigenous population, 42% live within 5 miles of where they lived when they were 14, and 60% within 20 miles. In Germany, the situation is very similar. Germany have done tests with accents, and there's things like the north-south divide, the Odingen line. Belonging to the group, I have to say, I do, and I hesitate to say most of you do, you probably fall into this rather dangerous thing called the global elite, it's quite surprising. But unfortunately, that's the way it is. So somewheres really do care about where they are and very specific things like that. Anywheres care less. Of course, it's a very crude definition. You have to look into the figures a bit more closely. It's much more nuanced than that. But a very, very useful, definition. I think as people who probably belong in the anywhere class that really care about somewhere, people involved in traditional architecture in an unusually unique position. And I would stress this, because I actually think this is terribly important. We're possibly at a moment when we can swallow hard, because I don't think I'd want to be associated with Front National. or Gert Wilders, nonetheless understand that there is a phenomenon out there, which is not all bad, it's a genuine phenomenon, and we have a particular place in it. Now that's something we debate at great length and get quite heated about, but I think it's worth quite worth making. And just in case we missed the point, remember our three leaders before. This is not just, you know, a politician's job, of course, is to reflect their electorate. This is not just a, you know, a sort of lower voting sector phenomenon. This is Donald Trump, a much better photograph of him, his Warsaw speech, and this is his obviously being very clear about his understanding of North Atlantic culture. And Xi Jinping, very interesting. I mean, there's a very strong, a whole series of factors. I've just chosen one thing, a whole series of factors of the wish to promote Chinese culture. And there are other things like, you know, less extravagant buildings. I don't think I'll pay too much attention in reality. But nonetheless, this contrasts this with the previous statements from national leaders, and it becomes quite striking. I mean, Vladimir Putin, well, his State of the Nation is 2013. I mean, part of that was about saying, you know, we don't want any homosexuals in Russia. We probably don't have any anyway. But I mean, there are the very distasteful aspects of this. But nonetheless, you realize that this is now coming from world leaders as well. So we are at a time of very significant change. I mean, the global economy is not going to go away. It's not going to collapse. But nonetheless, things are significantly changing. They changed first with the economic collapse, and now they're changing again. Another economist thing said, actually what's happening is that below the radar tariffs are starting to be introduced again. These are not big public things, but just that much becoming slightly more difficult country to country to move goods in and out. So where does that actually leave us? Well, the answer is I actually really don't know, because if I did, I'd probably make a fortune. If I could really predict the future, I'd take up horse racing. I wouldn't be here talking to you now. One thing we do know is that the great symbol, in my opinion, of the end of the iconic building is another Guggenheim building. Guggenheim building, which is going to be in Finland, was turned down. And the reason it was turned down, the director of Guggenheim said, was, well, they don't believe in globalization anymore. Interesting enough. I mean, wow. Interestingly symbolic. I mean, how clear that statement was about a year ago. So, if you like, it's the Guggenheim brackets, on the... Of course, all these buildings are falling down, they're suing people, kind of trials being sued all over the place. A lot of them have fallen out of function. Vitor Gravinsky's written very convincingly about this. But nonetheless, they still remain attractive in developing worlds. This one, actually designed by Dutch architects, was the one on the left, was heavily criticized for being a symbolic representation of the Twin Towers. They never occurred to them, actually, so they had to remove it. They just thought it was an interesting pattern. But this is my sort of penultimate slide. I've probably run out of time, as I have. This is my penultimate slide. I did try and find out if this was not just a European phenomenon, if it happened elsewhere. What I'm observing in Britain, I have checked with, in Europe generally, I checked with my friends who are architectural commentators, they broadly agree, is that the architectural extremes are flattening out. So, for example, this building on the right by McCrandall Lavington, people I know personally very well, I mean, they're a mainstream modernist firm. I said to them the other day, I said, well, if you put a cornice on that, I could have done it.
Right.
But if they don't, they're not embarrassed about it. This achieves considerable publicity. It's being, you know, a good building. Caruso St. John on the life of Landesbank in Bremen, they're a bit more explicit about it, actually, but they are effectively a mainstream modernist firm. But they have said that tradition is important. And David Chipperfield, who keeps telling us he's not being classical, but I think Andrew's to want him to say he was, because he's got vertical things with horizontal bit on top. it's not very much questioned that he was influenced by people like Schinkel. Now, this is I did actually write to certain people, none of them were in the room, and say, you know, would you mind telling me if this is happening in the United States as well? This is not, these are not traditional buildings in the normal sense of the word, but these are actually mainstream modernist architects who are starting to do things which actually lean much more heavily in that direction, without any embarrassment or whatever. Generally, we're experiencing considerably less hostility than we ever used to. So something is happening. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's an entirely European phenomenon or if it concentrates in Britain more than anywhere else. I'd be interested to know what's happening in the United States. This is not watered down traditional architecture. This is modernists believing that they should be doing something which has a traditional aspect to it. And we can take a view on this, but I regard this as very, on the whole, very good news. And what it means is that the ability to influence is, for people like us, if you like, to influence is much greater than it ever was. Because they don't just switch off. You can actually enter into a dialogue with these people. I mean, some of them are friends of mine anyway, it doesn't matter, but you can actually do it in architectural terms. And maybe this is, I don't know, you know, maybe this is an aspect of how populism is starting to affect the architecture. It will affect it. The only problem being that most architects absolutely belong to a caricature of a global elite, which is A, they don't really care what anybody else thinks, and they can jolly well tell them what they're going to have. That's one objection to the governing global elite. So they do tend to fall into that category, but there's no question it will have an impact. It'll have it slowly. Maybe this is the first signs, maybe it's not. I don't know, but I think it's very interesting. And I'd be very interested to know. Generally, these things are not bottled up in nations, actually. They tend to have a wider spread, but sometimes they're influenced, rather like the political system, they're influenced by other aspects. The French system for eliminating third electoral groups and so on. But anyway, I'm interested to hear more. And that's a very good time to test it out, seeing as I'm here and asking the question. But finally, rather more soberingly, I think this is probably one of the more important things, that all the urbanism that I do and all the things that we do are actually a boutique activity compared with probably the greatest and most significant issue we have at the moment in terms of architecture and urban design, the growth in urban growth in developing countries. This is the move to cities is unbelievably powerful. A lot of it is in what are now not are called informal settlements in order to make them less negative, as you see here in Brazil. Or the Chinese answer is just to build lots of town blocks. My election in China, the question I was asked every time was, what do you think of what we're doing? It's a rather difficult question, really. And I will always say, well, how can I be here for 3 weeks and tell you what you're doing? Is it any good or not? All I can do is tell you what happened when we did it. And it was not great. But I start to say the Chinese conditions are different, which is genuinely true. So there are very different answers to this. And actually in India, they try versions of this, which are not very successful. In Brazil, they try versions of it, which are more, you know, varies. Probably the most significant one is land ownership, is actually the informal settlements on expropriated land. And land ownership is the thing that makes a big difference. But that's my last slide, because I think it's a sobering thing. I can talk about theory, I can talk about populism, but actually, on a worldwide scale, this is by far the most important thing that's happening, for which we all, to a degree, are responsible. So, thanks for listening, and I would very much like to have some interesting and challenging questions. And any answer on my burning question, is that flattening out phenomenon happening over here or not? So thank you very much.
Will defy what has previously been categorized. So I'm imagining, you think it's possible that the new nationalism will bring the Barcelona, or sorry, the Bilbao effect kind of style of building into the new nationalism, into architecture of this period?
I think probably the global icon has probably had its day. I think. I mean, certainly in the developed world, they're just so outrageously expensive. And a lot of them don't work. The thing about global icons as advertising is there's a diminishing return effect. You know, if everyone has a Bilbao building, no one has one. But I might be wrong on that one. But I think what I'm speculating is that it's not. I mean, nationalism is what's always held up and as a sort of, you know, the negative aspect of populism, because nationalism got a bad name in the 1930s. There's nothing wrong with being patriotic. I assume we all are to a degree. But I think the idea that being anonymously international is a good thing is declining. And I think populism is one aspect of it. And I think there will be an architectural aspect of it. And I think that will come. If my thesis is right, which I basically believe it is, that architecture always follows policy, economics, and social change. The trouble is, it's very difficult to identify something when you're in it. I mean, politics is quicker. Its outcomes are slower, but politics brings things to fore much more quickly. Architecture is like, you know, it's like turning around a super tanker. You know, it does take a long time. But I believe it will. But I'm speculating now as to how it will. I believe it will. That's why I think it's a really important moment now, is that people like us should engage as much as we can, because being isolated doesn't help.
Let me ask you to speculate about a couple things, a couple scenarios that are long term, and it has to do, I think, with the effect of economics in these two scenarios. So, one scenario would be the continuation of the global economy that divides itself between the 25%, 20%, your term. Anywheres, right? And then the somewheres, who are on the lower end of the economic spectrum. And so one scenario is that the global economy continues to grow in the way that it does, and it becomes essentially an oligarchical, you know, kind of political arrangement, in which cities and their satellites come to look something like Pan Am in the Hunger Games, right? So that's one scenario, that there's just the continuation of the global city and the global economy means a kind of systemic inequality. And there's a question of whether or not that is sustainable, politically sustainable, economically sustainable. So that's one scenario. Second scenario is that, and I'm glad you showed this last graphic about the growth of cities. And it's very interesting that it goes to 2050, which is kind of the framework in which most of the younger people in this room would be thinking about it, far beyond, you know, you and I will live to see probably. But the
120.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah, well, some people are aspiring. So. What I'm interested in is sort of the other issue of worldwide demographics, that. 96% of the countries in the world have declining fertility rates. Now, some of them are still above replacement level, but a good sector of the world, particularly of the Western world, has fertility rates that for some time have been below replacement level. Western world, actually the modern world, the modern economy, so Japan, China, the United States, many countries in Europe, certainly the UK, Greece, Italy, and one of the effects of that, the long-term effects of that are masked by the fact that the population continues to grow until the last population above replacement level dies, and then it tanks. It tanks, and what you've got is a systemic situation where fewer young people, fewer working people are supporting fewer older people, which is a kind of recipe for economic catastrophe. There's no there's no record that I know of falling populations that have robust economies. And so that's another scenario about the long-term sustainability of the global city. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts or speculation about what seems a likelier scenario, or if neither of those are.
Well, two of them. The first one you said is a global economy. I'm not an economist, I don't know. I think what's happened is it's just flattening out. Is that very, very dramatic growth. It probably won't happen again, but it will probably grow, but at a much lesser rate. The impact of that is that, yes, while there is the free movement of capital, and there's debatable as to whether still there's free movement of capital, there's the extent to which cities will compete with one another for financial service. We're seeing this in Britain at the moment. London is a major financial centre, and Frankfurt and Paris want some of it now, because once we're out of Europe, which we will be, but actually probably what will happen is they'll open up branch offices in those capitals, which is already happening. Mm-hmm. So I think, there's a thing they say about city, it's a city of empire in a country that doesn't have an empire anymore. Mm-hmm. But its empire is actually the global economy. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that to some extent that's going to remain, and countries will still compete in the regulatory arbitrage. But I'm guessing, and that would be my guess. I mean, it's very difficult. The First World War was the thing that unpicked the last global thing. I hope we're not going to have one of those. Mind you, never know. And the demographic one is big. I mean, China's probably got the biggest problem of all. I mean, even its fastest population growth areas are well below replacement rate. Actually, Britain is at replacement rate. France isn't.
It's a replacement fertility, not just through immigration.
Debatable, actually.